We have a scheduled matter, which is to receive a presentation from the Sheriff's Office personnel on the operational and staffing plan for the jail housing addition, project number 8819, and consider adopting a resolution in support of the plan. Sheriff Bernal?
Good morning, Chair Adams, members of the board. I'd like to start off by clearing up a matter that 2 weeks ago when we presented this, there was some confusion about reports that we were supposed to present to the board that we put off. There have been two reports done, one that you're going to hear today, and last year my staff conducted hired a company to do a staffing study of the whole department. Patrol, corrections, and our admin, civil department as a whole. 2 weeks ago, I was under the impression that we were being accused of withholding, pulling this matter, hiding things, and that is far from the truth. We do not hide anything. We're very open. We're here to present this plan today. Last week, we got into the discussion, or 2 weeks ago, we got into the discussion of visiting. I believe the CAO, Dr. Bauman, and Don Cyril, he asked Don Cyril to come up with an option during visiting for in-person visitation. And I'm going to tell you that that is not even an option. I am not going to consider having a policy for in-person visitation during construction. Number one, it's not safe for the public. Number two, it's not safe for the deputy sheriffs. And three, it's not safe for the inmates. So that's not even a discussion. If we want in-person visitation after construction, that is an option, that is a viable option. I am not against that. The sheriff's office is not against in-person visitation with a glass between the inmate and his visitor, but it does come at a cost. And if the board is willing to accept that cost and grant us more deputy sheriffs, we're more than happy to continue in-person visitation. It's been in the plan the whole time. We did not hide that. Every time we present this plan, it's been the same. We never changed anything. We were going to video visitation because other counties do it. It works very well. In fact, I talked to the sheriff in Tulare County who just went to video visitation solely in January. And he said he not only gets compliments from the inmates and their families, but they get more visits. They get to visit on weekdays, scheduled visits when their loved ones, their children have birthday parties. They can get on video visitation and be right there in the home with the child during his birthday party. It works very well in Kings County and several other counties. Right now, Napa County does video visitation only because of earthquake damage. This is similar to Napa County. We're going to be going through construction. And for about a year and a half to 2 years, we're going to have to go to video visitation. And I think this will be a good test to see how well it works. But the option of in-person visitation is there for the end of construction. So with that, I'll turn it over to my Chief Deputy, John Mew, for this presentation.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you, Sheriff. Chair and board members, this is a bit of a revision. We went back, very thankful for Don, Searle, and Peter, and the work that they did to really try and help put some visualization behind these things. Very difficult to try and, you know, talk about the impacts of construction, how it's going to look, how it's going to impact our overall operation. But the work that Don put together here, I think, really helps kind of bring it all together. So as we look at the overall, the complex now, with all of the different labeling, this is how we look today. So I would draw your attention to the right hand side of the screen, all of the different parking areas over there, where all of the cars are parked in front of the jail. And as you'll see here in a minute, when we move ahead, we're going to lose 3/4 of that of our campus during construction. So that's how we look today. But hopefully by later this summer, once construction starts, this is how we're going to look. So all of the area in red, that was all parking just a slide ago. The first area in blue, the construction laydown, same. And then the area that's labeled construction trailers, same. That's where all of our transportation vehicles go. The vans that take people to and from court every day are all staged in that area. So you can see construction is going to have a major impact on how we're able to do business once we break ground. The little purple area up there where it's labeled visitation areas, that's what makes this such a hardship. That area is just completely landlocked. That is existing jail housing that's right there below it. And then again, off to the right, the red is construction, and then we have the lay down and construction trailers. So the fence that's there now, that will stay. We're going to have to maintain that, as that will still be the primary way to get transport vehicles in to get inmates to and from medical appointments, to and from court, to and from other places we have to take them in the community. So as you can see, we're going to be heavily impacted once we start. And trying to get people into that spot is beyond a challenge. We would either have to route them through the construction area itself, or we would have to look at routing them around some of the existing housing. And again, the difficulty there is between the transportation vehicles and all of the work that happens in there, trying to get people, pedestrians, safely in and around that loop is just a major challenge. So very appreciative. Don and Peter did a lot of work to try and come up with a path, to try and come up with a good viable option. We really had, there is an option, but it's not viable. Working around the women's section is no good, and trying to route people in there by the yellow area, there's too much contact with restricted areas. There's just too much movement that we would have to host. It would be completely, it's just not workable, because we'd have to work people in there by the public visitor area, and then try and keep them under escort all the way through secure areas of the complex until we can route them through over to the purple. So after we sat down, we spent a long time trying to grind through the options, and as the sheriff said, we couldn't come up with a good workable solution in the immediate term during construction. So as we talked about, the plan from the beginning was to go to all video during construction, and then as you all know, the plan was to go to all video after construction as well. Now, after the meeting a couple of weeks ago, as we said, we did have some routes, we did have some options to really worked out. Don had already come up with a way to move some of the fencing to where we would still have access to the existing visitation after construction. So that's what you see on the slide now. You see the addition when it's complete. You see the visitor parking that's all the way down in the front section. There will be a big video visitation suite in that front section of the building. And from there, the video visitation modules will go all in through the housing units. But for those people that want to have an option to visit in person, you can see the path. They had to move some fencing and move some things around so we could still access the existing piece where we host visiting today. And as the sheriff said, the biggest challenge is since this was planned as an all video visitation changeover, is just the people required to get it done, because as you can see, we're going to be escorting people. Though right now those are areas that are open to the public, but once construction's done, those will be behind secure fences. So there's going to be a lot of escorts required, but we've come up in conjunction with the plan that was worked out here to open up the pathway to get people in and out, and then we've worked out a staffing plan that will accommodate most of the areas in the secure side where we're actually supervising inmates out at the jail site itself, and then right out in front. That part will need to be done by peace officers. The rest of it, we'll do the original screening of people with deputy sheriffs in the front. And then we expect we can use civilians, once people are screened and checked in, to do all the escorts to get them back into the where they visit today. So with the other, a couple other questions that came up last meeting was as far as reallocation of housing and what we expected would stay open, what we expected to unoccupy again. We're going to work very hard not to formally close anything, because without being able to predict sentencing laws, criminal justice reform, anything that could cause a population surge for us, if we formally close down any of the older sections of the existing facility, the potential to open them, we wouldn't be able to open them up, because they were built to the standard of the day, and if we had to open them or rebuild them under a new standard, they wouldn't suffice. So what we hope is to be able to shut down, or you can see I put it on there, rehouse. We're hoping to rehouse those inmates into the addition. So between the rehabilitation center, the main jail, which includes all the way A through K, that we will gain about 498 beds, we'll unpopulate those and push those 498 people down into the new section that's 576 beds. We're still going to have quite a bit of work to do moving ahead. Our county dorms right now are overpopulated, and as a general rule, when the Board of State Community Corrections comes and rates our facility, they're looking at a building combined. They look at rehab and the main jail all as one rated capacity now, but it's 825 rated beds. We have about 930 people under the roof. So we are overpopulated, but there are some areas where we are more overpopulated than others. So we're still working on that, because our dorms right now, they are overpopulated, and we fully expect that once we gain capacity, the goal is to get everything, every compartment in the facility down below what its rated space would be. So as a for instance, we might have 62 people in a dorm right now that is rated for 50, but that just gets counted right now as, we're overpopulated, we're over capacity, and BSCC knows that. But once we gain beds, it would be very difficult to justify keeping those spaces over. So as we try and work on those numbers, it's going to have an impact on, of those 498, we're really hoping that we can push the maximum, push 576 into the new section, and be able to rehouse all of those inmates, and then not need the people we have working in those sections of the jail now. Every time we talk about this, I'll throw the caveat that we can't predict legislative changes. We can't predict if there's going to be a realignment version 2. We can't predict, there's a lot of things that could impact our population. If this bail reform measure goes through up in Sacramento right now, we could certainly see our population start to decrease, because as we talked about, we have a pretty fair number, we have a pretty high percentage of pretrial inmates in the jail right now. So all of those things that are completely beyond our control, this board's control, the sheriff's control, those are all things that could have a real positive impact on how we staff and populate this when we're done. And there are things that could have a negative impact, just depending on how they go. So as we talked about last time, I believe it's unanimous that we need these beds. I think everybody agrees. We have a very old facility. The rehab center was built in the 70s. It was built to a 1963 standard. So we are struggling with long time deferred maintenance issues and just things that fail over time in an old building. So the prospect of here in a couple of years having the newest section, the newest facility that houses inmates anywhere in the state, is very, very exciting to us, because we have a tough inmate population. It is a real challenge to house them, and those modern day beds built for those type of offenders with the accompanying program space and program areas is really a big deal. And that's we had a good participation. We had 11 different groups show up that have an interest in bidding on the project. That's very exciting news. That's almost double what Juvenile Hall had. So we're hoping that's going to keep it very competitive, keep the price reasonable, because at the end of the day, we need these beds.
Thank you very much for your comments. And I will take it to the board for questions. Start at this end.
What's the the RFP, you've got the bids will be coming in pretty soon for the construction, or what's the timeline?
Is John still here?
No hiding in the back.
Hey Supervisors, the crush is currently out the bid, and bids will be received on May 4th.
And then what's the timeline for submitting the staffing plan? Is there a timeline for this?
No, there's not a timeline on that.
Questions?
No, I'm sorry. We do, before we can award a bid, is when we need to have a resolution in place that supports the staffing plan.
Yes. For Don as well, that was one of my first questions. You know, usually a staffing plan is included kind of in the bid, right? Because you might have to make changes that you're talking about now on visitation. I just wanted to get clarity, because there was a question that came up after our last meeting, whether the staffing plan had been approved by the Board of Supervisors before taking it out on RFP to accept bids. What does the statute or the guidelines require? What has happened first? Or what's the required order of staffing plan approval and then going to a bidding process?
The staffing plan is necessary for the state's review of the overall project, and they received that prior to our award of bid. That's the process. And that can be submitted at any time during the design process. And ours is a little late on that. The state had reviewed our documents prior to this and did not ask for it.
But I'll review the statutes and make clear that at some point, the staffing report needed to be approved by the Board of Supervisors, which until today, it still hasn't been approved. And does the statutes also require that approval of the staffing plan before we can put it out for bid?
No, there's no stipulation about going out to bid. It's an award of contract.
Thank you. But for Deputy Chief Minot, I have several questions, because I think the public should know that we're talking about two separate things. One is visitation during construction, and then permanent visitation after construction is completed. On visitation during construction, can you show us on the map where is currently the entrance into the jail for the public to do the face-to-face visitation through the window?
So going back to the first slide, if you look at the on the right-hand side where all of the labels are, you see the one that says public entry and visitation.
Okay.
And it's right there at the front where the jail lobby is now.
Okay. That makes it clear for me, because under the proposed public and visitor parking during construction, we've all seen construction in major cities. San Francisco, most recently in Sacramento, is a big boom around the New Kings Arena. And these are bigger projects, multi-story projects. And it seems that the public could access traffic and pedestrian traffic are able to be maneuvered with proper fencing around these major projects. By, you know, in size and scope, they're much bigger than what we're proposing here. But it seems that there's a way to provide a gated access around that construction trailers area and then the construction laydown area, so they could access the existing visitor entrance. And that's why I was asking that. With some proper fencing, those areas could be gated off. Also, proper fencing between the entrance and the construction site. There seems to be a real feasible way for allowing that entrance and egress for the public, so they could continue to have visitation in the existing area. The other part of it is that usually these construction sites, there isn't construction happening on Sundays. So that's another question. Why would we go to a video visitation only for 1 to 2 years when we know that there isn't construction happening on Sundays? And that's also another accommodation where you're not going to have big vehicles back and forth. There won't be folks working at the construction site. But it seems like that question is a glaring one. Both proper entrances, during construction and even on Sundays when construction isn't happening.
So if you look at the slide that's up now, you can see that there's existing fencing there that secures that area. Once the construction starts and all of the fencing goes up, that area is going to be landlocked.
If you make it so, if you put a fence in, it'll be landlocked. But if you provide a pathway from the public visitors parking just along the side along that fence that curves around to the visitors area, fences could be moved easily. But it seems that there is a way where you could have a safe fenced off area so that there is that pathway to get to the existing visitation area.
We're still talking about walking through a construction zone. Who's responsible for any visitor that's injured in that construction zone? It's me.
That isn't construction. Those are construction trailers.
That's all within the construction zone. It's not safe for the public. It's not safe for the deputies. And number two, you're asking me to provide more deputy sheriffs for a longer route to the visiting area. Right now, for the very first time in many years, I've gotten caught up on my patrol staffing, on my sworn staffing, and we're slowly moving deputy sheriffs back out on the streets. I've got citizens calling me, telling me that they have a 2 to 3 hour wait for a deputy sheriff because I'm low staffed out on the streets. You're asking me now to focus more staff and have visiting on Sundays in the construction zone that's unsafe for my deputies, for the visitors, and the inmates. It's not possible.
Well, with all of you, I think we have a respectfully disagree on that point. Because as we mentioned, we've all seen larger construction sites in larger.
You're talking in public. You're talking in a public place. This is a jail. This is a secure facility. I'm responsible for the safety of the visitors, of the deputies, and the inmates.
Well, you were stating your position, which we've heard, but I'm laying out an argument that there is a feasible way where the public can still be accommodated to have in-person visitation, and there isn't construction going on in the construction and laydown area, nor construction trailers, especially on Sundays when there is no construction going on. And my second part of that was proper fencing, just as happens in major construction projects in metropolitan areas where there's the traffic, pedestrian traffic and vehicle traffic is much greater. Those projects are able to provide safety even in those types of larger projects. So I'm just questioning, even looking at the layout of the map, there seems to be a very feasible way for accommodating the public, in particular on Sundays when there is no construction going on whatsoever.
Let's just say that it is feasible, and we did have a tunnel that goes from the public parking over to the visiting area. You're not asking me to supply at least probably 8 to 10 deputy sheriffs for visiting. Because we have to escort them from the public visiting parking to the visiting area, escort them back. A lot of times they have children that they can only bring one child at a time in. We have to escort them back to get the other child and go back in.
So you're
talking staffing needs. Sure. We don't have the staffing to do that.
Are you currently saying that people who visit now and are parking in the parking lot or walking into the entrance to the visitation, you have deputies escorting them from the parking lot into the visitation area?
They don't. There's a waiting area right near the purple section right there. There's a waiting area.
Yeah, but my question is,
you're talking a construction zone. They would have to be escorted through the construction zone. It's not a safe area.
But Sheriff, are you currently providing escorts for the public when they're parking in the parking lot and walking to a visitation area?
They're not walking through or that close to a secure facility.
Let's go back to the first slide so you can show exactly how it is as it stands now.
So that part is open to you can see the parking lot, and you can see the entrance to the facility. The fence that surrounds, if you look on the left-hand side where it says women's area, units Q through B, that's the women's section. That area is all fenced. There is a vehicle, a sally port that goes up to that. So that's going to be access we're going to have transportation vans going moving in and out and through there. So trying to cross fence that with some other corridor to get foot traffic is would also require that we that we try and add, we'd have to add a whole second vehicle to Sallyport Gate. We're going to have pedestrians in that circle where we have vans, and that's, and we've looked at this. I mean, we didn't just walk in here today and take a guess. We spent a long time looking at this. Don and Peter spent a long time working at this, but ultimately, we've got to secure that jail. And you can talk about Golden One Center and the King's Arena. That's not a jail. We can't just let people mill around inside the secure perimeter of the jail. And we have a viable option. It is perfectly commonplace that services are restricted during construction when there's a major project like this going on. And we have a viable option to host that during construction.
That's not accurate because the areas I'm talking about are existing parking lots. Currently now, the public has access to the very areas that I'm talking about. You look at both those major parking lots that are utilized now that are going to be the areas proposed to be construction trails and construction laydown areas. We're talking about a pathway under that existing area the public can now walk and park as they're going into the visitor's entrance. It's this additional parking just on the other side of that entrance where you're saying the vans come in and out of. I'm unconvinced. I'm not an expert in the traffic. That's why I think it would be helpful for us at Board of Supervisors to get an independent opinion from another construction designer that could independently inform us. Is there a way to create a pathway into the existing visitation area that's safe to the public, but would still allow their families to have face-to-face visitations during this two-year period? Like I said, I'm not an expert in construction, but I think it would be helpful to the board to be able to have that independent review and to be able to inform us, is there a way to that is feasible and safe for the public to be able to do this?
Do you have another speaker?
Good morning. My name is Vera Roper. I'm the safety coordinator and investigator for the Monterey County Sheriff's Office. And in addition to working for them, I got my start in safety and construction management. I worked for a local civil engineering company for 5 years. And I can personally attest that construction sites are incredibly unsafe for the public. Not only is there going to be construction going on, if you can put up the one where all the sites are going to be, and the job site trailers are going to be there, there's going to be heavy equipment moving constantly that has incredibly limited visibility, there's noise obstructions, there's hazardous materials, and in addition to everything being fenced off, public construction sites and secure construction sites like we have to do because of the jail are extremely different. And in addition to that construction site, there's going to be a crane on site, which is going to have overhead hazards. Hard hats are going to be required. Construction workers are not looking for public to be in and out of their job site. I can't attest to Sundays when there's no construction going on. However, there's still going to be slip, trip, and fall hazards. There's still going to be spoil piles from trenching and excavation. There's going to be equipment out and about that we can't control. And in a perfect world, we need to keep it fenced. But public safety is at risk here. In addition to the construction going on, the sheriff's office, including myself, like the sheriff said, he's responsible for the contractors, the inmates, the employees, the public, everyone. We're already going to be managing the contractor safety, making sure they're up to OSHA regulations. We're already going to be managing employee safety because we have to look out for them. And that's without having to add increased staff. Construction sites are closed to the public for a reason. I cannot tell you how many claims I've dealt with personally from the construction site where people wander in where they're not supposed to. You have a public who's not used to construction sites. You have a public who thinks that it's fun for their kids to crawl on equipment, and it's not. It's dangerous, and they should not be allowed. The video visiting is for a short amount of time, and they've looked at it, and we've all analyzed it, that it is the safest route for everyone.
I hear your point of view, but again, we respectfully disagree because there's construction projects that happen in everyday life, and they're not absolute. They're not. When you see construction projects, you don't see large areas cutting off the public from either pedestrian or vehicle traffic. It's been too commonplace to see it happen in everyday life that it's not as absolute as you're articulating. And that's why, rather than trying to debate this here, I think it would be very informative for this board to get an independent review to determine, is there a safe way to do it? If that independent review were to say it's not possible, then that's one thing. But to come and restate what has already been said doesn't convince me any differently. The other question I have for Chief Manu, is what changes since our last meeting have been done to the video visitation in the new jail that would address some of our concerns in our last meeting? From what I see, the plan is pretty much the same, including the 30 public video visitation stations in the lobby area. Some of us had expressed concerns that that might be the primary way for the public to visit, but under the modified staffing plan we submitted, it seems to pretty much remain the same. Primarily, video visitation, 30 public stations with 4 private rooms equipped with 1 video visitation station in each. Can you let me know what's the difference between the first staffing plan versus this modified one in terms of how video visitation will happen permanently in the new jail?
Well, the video visitation suite will remain, so people have access to use those video stations as well. What has changed primarily is this, that there is a design, it is in the staffing plan now, that the new facility, or the addition, the housing addition calls for the use of both in-person and video visitation. The previous one didn't. It was exclusive to video. So you can see in the staffing plan that with the addition of some personnel for escorts and to get the public into what's the existing existing in-person visiting stations, that there will be, both options will be available, and they weren't last time.
So you were talking about in-person, or I should say face-to-face visitation in the new jail. Now we're going back, the modification is that we're just going back to utilizing the existing face-to-face visitation in the old facility.
So we're visiting it now, and considering where inmates are housed now, we trying to add some kind of video, or I'm sorry, some kind of an in-person add-on to the existing. It just adds to the inmate movement. We're visiting is today. Is much more centrally located. It's going to be an easier move to try and get inmates to in-person visiting than if we moved it. I mean, we still have to plan this as if, depending on population trends, that we may still end up with some inmates in the main jail or in KPOD or in the rehab center. And so we can't just plan that everything will focus around the housing addition because looking at our current population, if we're going to still get inmates to in-person, we need it to be as central to the bulk of our population as it can be.
Just to end here, my last comment, I think the modifications failed to address my concerns. Certainly we were talking about redesigning the new jail to provide in-person visitation there, and not having video be the primary means of visitation. This seems like the design is as it was last week, with now having a route for the public to walk to the visitation area and utilize the existing visitation area for the face-to-face visits. So this thing came up short in terms of addressing some of the concerns articulated to this. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much for your comments, Mr. Alejo.
If when you get it completed, and if we're going to have in-person visitation, how many? What does that entail as far as having personnel?
So the staffing plan, when it was an all video visitation, and when we considered that for the housing addition, it added a total of 11 people, with 9 of those being civilians and 2 being deputy sheriffs. If we add the in-person to the plan, then on top of those, it will add 10 additional. 7 of those being deputies, 3 of those being civilians. We hope to use civilians to do the escorts for on the public side, but we'll still need the deputies to supervise the inmates and then move the inmates to and from the visitation area and then supervise visiting while it's underway.
in-person visitation, in your opinion, is totally unfeasible during construction?
We can't do it during construction. There's going to be too much going on. I mean, I just would refer you back to what the campus looks like. That campus is going to be a real challenge for us just to continue, you know, normal operations.
And if we don't move on this fairly soon, I guess my concern a little bit is the timing, and if we're jeopardizing our funding for this project.
And I'd have to defer that to Don, but my concern is we all know we need these beds. We have more inmates than we have bed space, and we're, you know, not only from our perspective, but plaintiff's attorneys, the federal judge, everybody that has an interest in our jail right now has a keen interest in this project and seeing it go forward.
I've got just a couple of questions. Some are related to business, some are kind of not. But what is the percentage of inmate, the population, that are waiting to be sentenced?
It's about two-thirds.
So does it indicate that we've really got more of a court problem? You know, if there are so many people waiting, what's with that?
So in Monterey County, so the first thing, anyone that's booked on a misdemeanor, the penal code requires that we make an analysis to see if they are entitled to be released. Certain misdemeanors have to be released on a citation really right when they hit the door. So that's the first level of screening. And on top of that, in Monterey County, there is an order from the presiding judge that's an own recognizance release that applies to another group of people. So there's pretty good mechanisms in place to do citations where appropriate, own recognizance releases where appropriate. We are participating we're working with the courts on different means to try and address pretrial issues. One of the challenges with pretrial, and it's very commonly talked about, the percentage of inmates that are in jail for pretrial. They are entitled to the exact same sentence credits pretrial that they would be post-sentence. So just as an example, it's very common for somebody, they might be in jail for 6 months pretrial, and then they go to court, and then they take a plea, and it's a one-year sentence, and they get their half-time credit. And so they may do very little time, but it's not always a function of, you know, should they or shouldn't they be there. It's a lot of times they're there, they're working with counsel, they're working to try and get the best kind of a case negotiation as they can, but the minute that their plea is done, they get all those credits just the same as if they pled on day one or day 179 on a one-year sentence. They're out in 6 months just the same.
It just seems like we're absorbing a tremendous cost that might not even be ours. But that's probably a completely different issue that we're going to have to take up at another time. So that's one question. And then I just want to be sure I absolutely understand this, that the timing, that it's only going to be video, is simply going to be the 2 years during construction. As soon as that's complete, that we're going to reopen the plexiglass visitation. Is that as it stands now?
That's correct. And that's a slide I just put back up. They were able to work out a very workable path to get the public back in to where they are today. And keep in mind, we're trying to serve the entire inmate population. So the idea that it's a new jail is a misnomer. It is a housing addition to an existing jail. And we still have to account for serving the visiting needs of not just the people in the expansion, but the people in the traditional areas as well. So that's the advantage of keeping the spot that we have now, as it is more centrally located to take care of the entire population.
Okay. And then regarding the video visitation, it is true that the family members are going to remain in their homes. They do not have to come into the jail to do the video. They can do this from their homes in distant locations. Is that correct?
They can. The unlimited and always free all the time is come to the lobby, and they can schedule as many visits as they can work out, which is an improvement over where we are with in-person, because the confined quarters of in-person visitation, when people show up with, if they have a couple of children, we can only get one adult, one child in there. So the advantage of being able to keep them out in a less secure area, those that want to visit in bulk, will be able to do that. And that part will, I mean, they should see a noticeable noticeable improvement. Those on-site, in the lobby, those visits are free and unlimited. If somebody wants to use the internet to connect remotely from home, from another state, from somewhere else, then there is a connection fee there, and we haven't, I don't know what that number is yet, because we don't have that available through, we don't have it yet.
I didn't realize that there was going to be a fee for that kind of visitation, because I thought that's what this whole thing was based on.
No, anything that's remote where they have to connect over the internet because of the different firewall technology and the stuff that the vendors have to use when somebody's gonna visit from a house, those are fee-based. The other ones where people come to the lobby, or if they want to come to the site just like they do now, they'll have unlimited free.
I guess I'm sort of missing the great advantage of having video visitation if it puts a cost burden on the families of inmates who are probably already suffering from some real, poverty issues.
Well, if they want to come to the jail and visit like they do now and be able to visit in bulk with all their kids around them, they can, and it's free.
But only by video.
If they want to, no, or in person. But only one, adult plus one. There is a keen interest for people that are willing to pay a fee rather than drive for 2 hours.
I can't help but we're talking about keeping the in-person video or the in-person visitation open after construction for the people that can't afford video at home for one. Video is available at the lobby of the new addition for free. In-person visitation will still be available, just as we're doing it right now. People that don't want to drive, they might live out of state, they'll have to pay a fee, but they can visit without that long-distance drive to the jail.
Do you have any idea what you would need at this point?
I don't know.
I mean, is it like $10 a minute, or is it, got some muttering going on for the board. Pardon me?
We're asking questions.
I mean, if they can't afford the fees, we're going to keep the in-person visitation open. It's an easy fix.
Okay. Do either of my colleagues at the end of the desk have some questions? Comments?
Yes. I had a couple questions. I do want to hear from the public, but I want to make sure I understand. So I had some questions about both the during construction visitation as well as post-construction. So it sounds to me as though there have been no design changes to the new construction to accommodate in-person, face-to-face visitation once the new addition is open within the 576-bed facility, right? So
Don can correct me if I'm wrong, but it's such a small footprint that we can't fit. You're talking in-person video or in-person visitation in the addition,
right?
Yeah, it's such a small footprint that from what I understand, they just can't fit in-person visitation into that addition. Now keep in mind, we are going to keep it available to where it is right now. Mm-hmm. So it's still available.
Yes, you said that. But part of what was spoken about often in the staffing and operational plan was to move the inmates as little as possible. So I guess my question is, why not? There are several visitation rooms for professional visits that are within the housing units. I guess I'm wondering why there hasn't been any consideration of making those into an area. It would be huge, wouldn't completely address the need. We'd still have to have the other. But I'm just, if your goal is to keep the inmates from having to move around a lot, why wouldn't you find a way to, put a glass or a plexiglass thing in those areas that you've already created within the housing units?
Because we'd be moving the public right into the belly of the jail. And if we can move those inmates now, we can move them and keep them contained always in the brick and mortar and get them back over to the areas where we visit now, but we'd be bringing the public right into the most secure parts of the new housing addition, and that's just that is very problematic to try and get the public into those spots.
And the area that now is the video visitation, there's no portion of that where you could bring, have some be video visitation, but mm-hmm. others be plexiglass where inmates could be on the other side of a glass.
So that front, the very front part of that building, that's all just general commercial grade construction. That's not designed to be an institution or to confine people. So we would, again, we'd be bringing people outside of the secure parts of the jail, out of the brick and mortar, to try and get them out there. And as it's configured now, no, there's, I mean, that's all set up to be, it's completely a public suite out there.
One question I had when I was reading your report, you say towards the end that no minors will be housed or moved through the facility. I had concerns about whether minors were going to be able to visit a parent who might be in the jail. It now looks to me as though your passageway for face-to-face visitation is exterior to the jail. But I just want to make sure that minors are still going to be able to visit.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. The visitation plan that you have in the existing area that you're proposing for post-construction, how is that different? Is it different in any way from the current visitation plan? And has there been some examination of, I don't know if there are best practices to visitation, but are we looking at once the addition has been constructed, and we're having visitation, are there enhancements to, things we know about things that are more beneficial for rehabilitation, for instance?
As far as different types of visiting?
Mm-hmm. Are there ways to conduct visitation that are, have we learned anything recently about how to do that in a way that's more beneficial to maintain the family ties or to increase the chances of rehabilitation rather than recidivism? I'm not sure, just a question.
That one thing I've learned from people who have gone to all video visitation is the inmates like it better because they get more visits. They're not just scheduled visits on the weekend, they're more visits throughout the week.
And it is an advantage because now, based upon inmate movement, when we have to go to court, when we have to go to the doctor, all the traditional movement that really draws us down, there is going to be some advantages for those that want to try and augment with video because they don't have to live by a schedule that we set based upon staffing. So they will have access to more visits, and I think everyone would agree that the more connection people have with their families while they're locked up it leads to a happier inmate population, which is very good for us and leads to better outcomes in the end.
Thank you. Yes, I think the operative word there is augment. It was just a bit of a shock to learn that it wasn't going to be an augmentation, it was going to be a replacement. So I think, making sure that we really have the face-to-face visitation, and I think, making sure we find a way to do that during construction if we possibly can. It's huge. 2 years is a long time if you're supposedly only in jail for a year.
I'll tell you right now, it's just not possible.
Thank you. You've said that. And I still say I think it's important that we see if we can figure it out. Another question I have is there is a mention that the Sheriff's Office is going to utilize a work alternative program participants to clean the public areas of the jail, and this is supposed to decrease the possibility of contraband being entered into the jail. So I guess I have two questions there. One is, normally I would think the janitorial service is probably represented by labor. I guess, does the union know about this, and do they have an opinion? And then, I'm not clear how work alternative participants would be somehow better in terms of contraband as opposed to genders.
As it stands today, we have civilian staff that work with inmates to take care of certain areas inside the jail. So anytime we take an inmate that's confined and bring them out to a public place or a place where the public has access or visits, it increases the risk of contraband. It's very common for visitors to show up, to drop things in garbage cans, to leave things hidden in bathrooms, and then try and get a message to an inmate that's going to come out to clean, that's ultimately going to go back into the secure area. So if we can utilize alternative custody folks that are not going back inside, then there's a lot less incentive for people to try and drop those things because the chance of them getting back inside shrinks.
Thank you. That has some logic to it. The other thing is the plan in several areas refers to protocols and policies of the Sheriff's Department. Certain things will be handled according to those policies and protocols. We don't have them attached to this, so there's not really a way for us or the public to know what those are and to know, to what extent they might need the operational needs from the public's perspective. I'd also like to understand, so I think those need to be attached to the staffing and operational plan. I'm also curious about how those protocols and policies get amended, if they do, and what the Board of Supervisors' role is in that. And I wonder if County Council, I don't know if that's something that you can speak to off the top of your head, or whether that's something to return to us, but I'd like to have a feel for that. Who can amend the policies and protocols of jail operations and how?
The sheriff does that.
Okay, so the Board of Supervisors and the public really doesn't have any input into how the jail is run.
No.
Okay, and then, so another question I have has to do with sort of the changing story that we've been hearing. So in various towns, I can't remember if it was 2013 or 2014, we were told that no new staff would be needed to once the addition was built. And so and at that time we were told that assertion had to do with staffing and operational models that might be possible. So now we're being told that this is the staffing and operational plan that is going forward. We don't really know the analysis behind it. We've been presented with a plan. And I think because of some of the issues that are being raised, I prefer to sort of take a step back and see if there's another analysis that we could have done in relatively short order to understand whether we're really staffing and operating the jail in the most effective way in terms of best practices and also cost effectiveness. This has huge ongoing budgetary implications, and as you know, we're going to be hearing about the budget later today, and I think we really need to analyze this very carefully, particularly because each time there's something that comes forward that the sheriff doesn't seem to like, there's an assertion that it's going to create a need for a lot more staff, and there's kind of this threat that we're going to have to pay for that. So I'm not sure that that's the model I really would like to follow. So I guess I'm wondering if I'd like to ask the CAO whether we might be able to have county staff work with the Board of Supervisors to get an independent look at the staff and operational models that might be possible. Looks like we're kind of locked into a lot of the design piece of this, but whether there are some ways to tweak that, and certainly the operational and staffing plan that might be a little more manageable for us currently and into the future.
Can I make a comment? You said every time something comes up that the sheriff doesn't like, there's a staffing issue. It's not that I don't like in-person video or in-person visitation. It's just that I'm making you aware that it's gonna cost more staffing. It's not that I don't like it. I want what's best for the public. I want what's best for the inmate, that keeps them from coming back into jail, bonding with their family. And I think it's unfair for you to say that I don't like it.
Okay, with all due respect though, we can use different language, but let's say if you like face-to-face visits and in-person, sir, if you liked in-person or face-to-face visiting more than you do, you might have designed, had the addition designed differently.
Again,
we can use different words. There are different priorities and different values here. My question was actually for the CAO.
So thank you. So we'll just hold the minute while we hear from the CAO.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Supervisor. I think respecting the Sheriff's authority, nevertheless, your board certainly could direct our office to conduct whatever independent reviews deemed appropriate.
And because I know we do have a time constraint here, we do want the the addition. Do you think it's feasible that could happen by the end of May, say, so that we're still within the parameters of more or less of the bidding and awarding process?
I think there's a separation between ensuring that we comply with the state requirements so that we can ensure that we maximize our opportunity to draw down state funds for this facility and still retain flexibility to amend the staffing plan as we move forward. So I think a timely, thoughtful study in that regard would be more fruitful. In the longer term, with respect to the construction issue, we certainly can bring in a construction manager to take a second look, fully understanding the sheriff's obligation to provide a safe place for not only the visitors and his inmates, but our staff as well. And we certainly can see if there's a creative solution to that challenge.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I respectfully disagree. I don't think it's for us to tell the sheriff, elected sheriff, how to staff his jail. And I've been and had video visitation as well as the others, so I don't think it's the worst thing I've ever seen. In fact, I think it's better than the face-to-faces that exist now. And so I don't see any, and it doesn't take a brain surgeon to know if you're having in person, you're going to be transporting people to and from, you're going to add some personnel. So I don't have distrust for the sheriff's department. I think we ought to move forward on this.
Yes.
Good morning. Mike Moore, Under Sheriff. I just wanted to clarify a couple things as I was listening to this. And again, I like to say that Supervisor Alejo has got this right. This is two different issues, right? It's the in-person or video visitation during construction, which was looked at by safety personnel, by RMA, by our people, and it's the sheriff's office and the sheriff's sole responsibility as the elected sheriff to set policy on security of the jail facility. And it's just not a feasible thing to do. The other side of this was after a couple weeks ago when the board directed our office to look at a plan to bring the in-person visitation back in. That's what you're looking at here. It is an addition. I do want to remind everybody that we keep talking about different plans or changing the design. The 576 bed facility, the way it's designed right now, has been approved by this board. Those plans have been sent off to the state finance, the fire marshal. It's taken us about 3 years to get all that approved. Any augmentation to this design, the 576 facility bed, to change it, to bring something else into it, or change the design, requires to start this whole process again with state finance, fire marshal, BSCC. It could set us back even another 3 or 4 more years, depending on what it is. The second thing I want to talk about is we're talking about assigning out another staffing study, and Supervisor Parker's comment that we added these bodies, or the sheriff's office added bodies to within, like, it is completely false. And I don't know why we would need to do another independent study of the staffing study. The staffing study that you're looking at that's attached to this was not done by the sheriff's office. It was given out to an independent through RMA. It was Kitchell's design. So to redo that one and have another staffing study would just, again, set us back. So again, we're looking at two different issues. Are we going to stop this project right now, the one that we all think we need, or the one that we all know we need, and all of us who are involved in litigation and everything else, are we going to stop this project simply because there won't be in-person visitation during construction, which is not a feasible thing?
Okay, thank you for your comments. And I need to go to the public for comment as well before we bring it back to the board for vote.
Hello, Thomas Lee, Monterey County Jail Coalition. Thank you to the supervisors today, and particularly for Supervisor Parker for really digging into this issue. I think it's important. Thanks to the Sheriff's Department for an effective presentation. I wanted to reiterate how important in-person visitation is to visitors. Our coalition has been out there on visiting days and spending sometimes hours just talking to people ready to visit. And sometimes there's quite a wait involved. And just noticing how important it is to them, how they traveled a long time, this is a big deal to them. This is also borne out by research into in-person visitation, and it's been proven to reduce recidivism. In other words, this is a public safety program, in-person visitation. It isn't fluff for the families or for the inmates. This is a way of reuniting families who are, people who are incarcerated often have conflicts with families as well as with society. And this is a chance for them to work those out before being reunited. This is a big deal. As a part of video visitation is promising, but we don't know too much about it. We don't have much research about it. I read one study that suggests that there are concerns about it. So we don't really know whether it's the way to go yet. I wouldn't want us to make a mistake and rely on it and throw away a really effective program. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments.
Good afternoon, Chair Anderson, members of the board. I'm Jay Donato, SIU Local 521. I have two questions on this. First is that, it's kind of self-serving, is that I go and visit, have meetings with non-sworn staff there. I currently go through the visitors going right now, and I'm curious as what's the access for a person such as myself. Public defenders go there to talk to their clients, the investigators. You have bonds people going there. And a lot of staff going in and out of there. You have the deputies, you have the non-sworn. I see lots of medical people, so I'm curious as to what's going to be the access points during this process. And then secondly, because I know we're spending millions of dollars on security upgrades currently on the jail, and I'm wondering if that's going to be money spent on areas that are going to be decommissioned, and if so, can we use that money more wisely? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Turner.
Good afternoon. My name is Eric Peterson. A few years ago, some years back, I visited a woman who was in the state prison in Chowchilla. She'd been convicted of murder. We visited, sitting at a table in a nice bright room with other people sitting at tables visiting with little kids. If the state of California can handle something like that, I certainly don't understand why the Office of the Sheriff can't. Two things. In the United States of America, there is a presumption of innocence. In the remarks by representatives of the Office of the Sheriff, there seemed to be a presumption of guilt. I don't know what country you're from, but it certainly is not the United States of America. Secondly, maybe what we need to do, if the sheriff can't do the job, or the sheriff can't do the job without a lot of whining, maybe we need to get a sheriff who can do the job. Thank you.
Good evening, supervisors. I'd just like to say, probably on behalf of the whole entire community, thank you to Supervisor Parker and the Alejo for truly digging into this. The community truly appreciates your dedication and passion. I come to speak in support of the in-person visitation. Because yes, in my opinion, and from the sheriff's it is going to cost more money, but you know what, long term, I mean, it will actually save us money by continuing in-person visitations, because you will see that in-person visitations, like stated before, lower the recidivism rate because it allows inmates to visualize a life outside of that incarceration. It allows inmates to have their morale boosted, and you know, it says to them, maybe if I behave, I'll continue to see my family outside of these confining spaces. And most importantly, I served on the Youth Advisory Commission for the city, and Jane Parker appointed me to the Monterey County Mental Health Commission. I have a real passion for our youth, and for me, when I see this, it just red flags, it's going to affect our youth, because 2 years may seem like a little bit of time, but it's a lot of time for the development of children. 2 years is 4 to 6, 2 years is 10 to 12, I don't have to tell you the math, but I mean, that's a lot of time to not see your parent in person. So I hope that this board does the right decision and decides to go with in-person visitations. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments.
Catherine Crumpin of BC Side. I want to thank the supervisors for bringing this very important issue to light. I want to thank you, Supervisors Parker and Adams and Alejo, for recognizing the importance of in-person visits in preventing recidivism and for promoting successful rehabilitation. There is a place for electronic visitation for in-person for visits, but numerous studies show, including the Minnesota Department of Correction study, the effects of prison visitation on offender recidivism concludes that denying in-person visitation undermines community safety and increases recidivism. The Prison Policy Initiative Report, which is based on the 2011 Minnesota Department of Correction study, the effects of prison visitation on offender visitation recommends that correctional officials and procurement officials do the following. 1, explicitly protect in-person visits and treat video only as a supplemental option. 2, refuse commissions. Commissions drive up the cost to families, which leads directly to lower communication. 4, 3, scrutinize contracts for expensive bells and whistles, things that facilities do not need, insist on removing items, and instead have lower the rates. 4, when putting in video visitation systems, put some thoughts into where the terminals are placed so as to maximize privacy. And 5, refuse to sign contracts that give private companies control over correctional decisions, including visitation schedules, when it is acceptable to limit an incarcerated person's visitation privileges, or the ability to of people to correct in correctional custody to move within a facility. I encourage the board to carefully consider alternatives to going to a permanent all-electronic video visitation system. Thank you.
Thank you for your comment.
Good morning. My name is Don McPherson. I'm a resident here in Salinas. First, my thanks to the supervisors who are digging into this issue and asking questions. Certainly, as elected, you understand when your name goes on a ballot, there's always room for discussion. And so I was dismayed to hear earlier someone who is elected say there is not room for discussion. Perhaps that's why he couldn't find his way to an immigration forum at this time. But on the matter at hand, while I have not had to rely on video conferencing to speak with family who are incarcerated, I did have to rely on for almost 5 years as somebody who lived abroad for a year and a year and a half at a time. And one thing I have to say about this is video teleconferencing, while you do get to see your family, especially when it comes to your parents, and many of you probably know my mother, you can't pick up on how they've aged, how time has treated them. And so one of the things that's made me stay here in Salinas after living abroad so long is when I came home and saw my mother, I could never have realized through teleconferencing how much she had slowed down. And this was a woman who had been active in many of your campaigns, walking through these streets in these counties. I could have never seen that from teleconferencing. And more importantly, trying to get somebody who's elderly to use these services, no matter how patient you are, is almost an impossibility, to use the sheriff's words. You know, I don't know how many hours I've spent trying to teach, you know, elderly relatives how to use this technology. And this is for the stuff that has been used for years and years, such as Skype, such as FaceTime. And if you're telling me there's a possibility of another private entity coming in who is not only going to charge, but most likely is going to have a customer service system where if any of you ever call a customer service center, you know they're not very helpful. I encourage you, look into the alternatives to making this possible. Because teleconferencing, I went through it for almost 5 years, you don't get the true picture of what not only your family's going through, but the shape of the room. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
Hello, my name is Aaron Bernal, and I'm part of BoS Mtg Leadership and Empowerment. I'm also representing Luis Alejo. I'm pretty pissed with listening to what's going on. There's a way to everything. There's always a way to forget. We all know that. But if I have to stand in jail and get comments from people that are visiting their loved ones, I will, because we're here to make decisions for the community and represent the community, and not what certain talking here wants or thinks is best. So I'll be most likely getting inputs from family members or people that visit their loved ones. I'm running out of words right now, so I'm pretty mad. But with that said, just don't agree with the whole visitation thing, of video visitation. If we didn't have this technology, what would be the other option? I don't know if you thought of that. Only this technology is now so advanced whatsoever, but that's about it.
Thank you for your comments. I'm Sylvia Shee again. I really want to thank the Board of Supervisors for taking such a close look to it, because the in-person visitation actually has benefited to the society, to the safety of the society, and you recognize that. And there are different models as a starting point to go out. You know, in the European countries, in Norway, the jails are completely open. You don't feel such fear. You have to guard everyone walking every step. So someone has mentioned that could be a different model. So as we progress through society, I would like to see that happen. It makes us all quite safer, and it saves a lot of money. And so I have really to compliment all of you looking into it so closely. And I also thanks the Sheriff Department. You have brought them forward, taking a different look. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Mike Roberts. I'm a Salinas resident. Running a jail is very, very difficult. My father ran a jail, and he shared that with me. Building anything is very difficult. So you imagine the two things together are nigh impossible. But that being said, after the whole process is finished, we need to emphasize person-to-person business. For the simple reason, I'm here talking to you as a person. You don't have a screen back here which members of the public address you. This is very important. As a teacher, and I retired as a teacher a while back, I had students over the years who, oddly enough, looked forward to going to the prison to see parents or loved ones. And I can only imagine what it would be like for them to have made the sacrifice to have gone trip, maybe just eat in restaurants, go to a hotel, the things that go along with a long distance visit, to be told at the last minute, well, the video conferencing thing is broken and we can't use it today. Someone got mad and kicked it or something, who knows. But it's hard enough to do the thing, but to deal with the potential technical difficulties in that, which aren't part of our situation right here. If I didn't have the microphone, I could simply speak louder. Again, just to emphasize, it's very important, like Jim had pointed out earlier, in a child's development to have contact with loved ones. Any other thing you've heard besides that? But I'd add my voice to that. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your comments.
Yes, again, you read via with NEPA. I don't know where to start. So many different things, so many points. It's going to come from my heart, like, oh, that does the best way in person. Man to woman. I definitely in support of independent review, although, I mean, I myself, where there's a will, there's a way, and it's, to me, it's discouraging to see that, you know, there might not be a will by an elected official. And I do feel that independent review is important because I don't have faith in him because of what I see here and his stance on certain things. And I understand he has a tough job to do as well. And I tip my hat to him and their partners. So I am in support of a review. I do feel like, man, I've also been around job sites and construction. I'm not no expert, but, you know, there's definitely, I've walked with plenty of paths that are, you know, 10 feet, however it needs to be to make sure that it's a secure path. I feel that's very feasible just from looking at it. You know, just that highlighted part, move it a little bit. It's possible, I feel. I also am strongly against the in-person visitation simply for 2 years. I don't know if the lady who spoke earlier, just this, you know, short time period, if you've ever been incarcerated, ever had a loved one incarcerated, I've been incarcerated there. First time in the jail was there over 2.5 years, that's 800 some days, and 2 years is 760 days. That's a long time if you're sitting in there and you're away from your kids, you're away from your family. And for them, they're away from their parents as well. So that is not just simply 2 years. That's a long time when you're there for 2 years. So again, I also want to thank you guys for the level of questioning and digging deep. As other folks have said, I hope that we continue to dig deep on these important issues and other in moving forward, that we continue this dialogue. I feel like we've been, you know, not only listening, but we've been heard, and I really appreciate that because that's not always the case. But yeah, as a community member formerly incarcerated, I definitely stand firmly by maintaining in-person visitation. I also want to challenge, even though I don't see, you know, they might not see, I also want to challenge our sheriff in the future to maybe consider contact visitation as an incentive, because that will definitely help keep some people out of trouble. I know I would have stayed in trouble if that was an incentive for me, right? Thank you guys again.
Thank you for your comments.
Good afternoon. Buenas tardes. René Casas, resident here at Salinas. Also a program and policy coordinator for an organization called MIPA, Motivating Individual Leadership for Public Advancement. I think there was a lot of issues raised up and a lot of concerns regarding the last meeting and the failure to provide some of those additions and or updates. You know, as I'm looking at the current construction and the plan, if I can ask the sheriff if he can go ahead and put, where would the visitation site be during construction? We did see the zones of where the construction was going to happen, but not where the video visitation was going to take place. That will allow me to see if that's going to be towards the path of where construction is going to be happening, because we also have to keep in mind the safety of those individuals, as you all bring it up. I think 28 months ago, when we were having a discussion of where those $88 million was going to come to for the new juvenile hall and the construction of the jail, you know, I really want to uplift the work of the probation department for taking a holistic approach and involving community members and different departments to the table to talk about the construction of the new juvenile hall, something that I would also encourage the sheriff to do, to bring community members and other organizations, as a failure and or lack of communication between the board and the sheriff's department. Another thing and issues that come up is that I hear the sheriff say that inmates really want a video visitation. However, is there a survey that was provided to the inmates so that we could see the data that shows how many inmates would want to see video visitation rather than in-person visitation? A third thing is, you know, during the construction and the safety, I also understand that there's an ICE agent at the jail. And looking at the path that he's going to take to go inside the jail, maybe it's going to be a hazard if he goes in through the current construction zones. I'm also looking for the safety of that ICE agent. Possibility of not having that ICE agent for 2 years outside of the jail. Another thing that's being brought up is that, is this current ICE agent that's in the jail, does he have his own space? If so, is that space being rented out to the Department of Homeland Security? If so, what is the current cost that's being provided for that ICE agent to be at the jail? Something that the board could take a look at and see how to use those funds to go towards maybe hiring another sheriff, to maybe increasing the path toward visitation. And lastly, a really good thing that was brought up around bail and the bail schedule is you look at Santa Cruz County, and just one of the issues that's being brought up is, you know, failure to control a dog, a misdemeanor, it's a $500 bail charge in Santa Cruz County. You look at Monterey County, $7,500. So you see the money-wise between Santa Cruz County and Monterey County. So as we're seeking towards a bail schedule and looking to reform that, you know, we're here willing to be at the table to provide some guidance. I was at an immigration convening yesterday in Los Angeles and learning of ways in which, you know, we could work with partners and other people to bring forth, some of those organizations and or ideas here in Monterey County. So I want to thank you all very much and have a wonderful day.
Thank you very much. Do you have the public wishes to comment or bring it back to the board?
Hi, Wes Wisely is resident on. I support your looking into an independent review of trying to do a pathway for in-person visitation. I kind of see this as just another episode in the saga of mass incarceration and privatization and monetization off of making people incarcerated. I mean, the surcharges for booking when you go to put money in on the books for people to pay for collect phone calls to have visitation over the phone. And then with this, you know, you're going to have surcharges. So it's all being privatized, you know, off of a public service, I guess. Or it's, you know, it hurts me. It hurts me deeply. So I see this, and thank you for looking into this, and please do that independent review of the pathway.
Thank you very much. Can we bring you back to the board? Any additional comments from our board members? We'll start with this one this time.
Well, you know, our jails have been kind of changed over the last number of years. ABO 109 changed them completely. It used to be a place for people to stay awaiting trial, and then they went to prison. A lot of people that went to prison before now are staying in the jail longer. So it's complicated, and it's impacted not just Monterey County, but other counties. And, you know, I've been, in the course of my career, I've been to every prison, I think, in at least the old prisons, Folsom, San Quentin, obviously Soledad, and the ones down here. And they do have in-person, mostly contact visits, but they have a heck of a resource and personnel to manage those. And so all those factors have to be considered into it. Like I said, AB 109 changed the complexion of our jails considerably, and we didn't get the funding to provide for it.
So thank you, Vice Chair. Thank you for the discussion. Very, I think, helped me in terms of figuring out our views on how to deal with the inmate population. One of the things I do know is that this project is needed, certainly needed, and Senator Alejo helped get the funding a while ago. So we recognize that. I think we're all in agreement with that. And certainly I appreciate the fact that there will be in-person, that option for in-person contact when this project gets done. So the issue, I think, now comes down to the two-year period here in terms of the in-person. And I support it. I think it's important. I think we've got to explore all opportunities to be able to offer that as an option for those inmates that I think the sheriff can determine who are eligible for that. And I think one of the speakers indicated this could be an incentive for good behavior. And I would suspect that those that are in there would want to have this option and this choice. So how we get there, I don't know. I mean, I'd like to see. I think Supervisor Alejo brought up the issue of an independent analysis. Again, we can look at it. I'm not adverse to looking at it. And at the end, maybe we can convince the sheriff that there is a way to do it secure, not only for the sheriff, for the inmate, but also for the public. And it is a jail, so we have to keep that in mind in terms of how we provide the security and make sure that even the public, the visiting public, doesn't get into any issues there that could affect them. So I'm willing to go that route. So in my views, we ought to, I think, support the staffing so that the project keeps moving, but we continue looking at
short term, how do we come up with an option that the sheriff would be willing to work with them to be able to have a face-to-face, in-person contact during the two-year construction period? It sometimes can turn to 3 years or 4 years. We know that projects sometimes tend to get longer and longer with delays. So that is also weighing in my mind in terms of how do we truly explore all the opportunities and options to be able to have in-person during the construction phase.
Thank you. Supervisor Alejo and then Supervisor Parker.
Thank you. I just want to make clear that I've been one of the biggest advocates for this new jail or jail wing or jail facility, whatever you want to call it. It's an issue of semantics. But in 2013, I fought to get an additional $43 million for this jail after San Joaquin County passed up its jail money to put Monterey County next in line. And there was a senator from San Mateo County who introduced two pieces of legislation that was trying to put their county in front of our county, and I went out of my way to defeat the legislation so Monterey County could get the additional $43 million. We probably wouldn't be even talking about this new jail facility without those additional $43 million of the work we did to make sure Monterey County got what it was prioritized to receive from the state. So in light of AB 109, the state did give money in terms of this jail facility, over $8 million for us to have this conversation today. But with that, I also want to weigh in on how this new jail is going to function. And the way our system of checks and balances work, we do weigh in. As a legislative body for the county, we control the purse, we control the funding, and so we can weigh in and put weigh in on how the jail is going to work, how visitation is going to work, when we control the funding for our sheriff's department. But there is a lot of concerns expressed here today. Certainly with a growing for-profit industry that's really trying to push video use of video-only visitation in jails, there is other companies that are trying to profit. In some counties, they charge $1.50 a minute. Sometimes they do a flat fee, $10, $20 for a certain amount of minutes. But that's what brings that we're talking about for those that would be utilizing video visitation from other cities. There would be, it is a significant cost, and you multiply that by hundreds of visits. It is concerning that we're contributing to a growing for-profit industry that's trying to put these charges on the families who many times can at least afford it. The other part is the concern I had was we're talking about a design of a new facility that's supposed to be more efficient, require less staff, using the best practices. But with this building, we're talking about more inefficiencies, requiring more staff, and now perhaps doubling the number of staff that we just heard 2 weeks ago. So we're going in the opposite direction. We should be talking about having greater efficiencies with a new state-of-the-art jail facility. That's what it was always intended to utilize and the benefits of that to a particular county. And the other concern was, as soon as this issue was raised, because the community was never, input was never solicited from the community about the jail visitation plan, nor was it solicited by the Board of Supervisors. As soon as it became public at our March 8th budget meeting, we immediately raised concerns, as did the community. But this was allowed to go so far in the bidding process and the design process that now they're trying to force us as supervisors to say, it's too late now. It's too late to have to design or redesign when it really should have came to us first, so that we could sort out these visitation issues and then to be able to design this new jail facility that would accommodate face-to-face visitation through a glass window. And that's why I think that it's unfair to us as supervisors to have released the staffing report so late and had gone forward with the bidding process and now to try to tie our hands and say it's too late, it's gonna cost too much money, it's out for bid, when we should have been having this discussion much sooner, many months ago. And as we stated at our meeting 2 weeks ago, the staffing report came out in August. It would have taken an email to send it to our county staff and to the Board of Supervisors, but that didn't happen until a few days before the March 8th meeting. So I certainly would support an independent review so that we can look at practical ways to provide visitation during construction and after construction to the public. And I'm kind of surprised that the updated staffing report says we would require another 10 to 11 staff. No redesign has been done in the new facility, so there's no new staffing needs there, and we're using the existing old jail. We're already staffed, we're already providing face-to-face visitation, so the math doesn't seem to work. we're only using them what already exists, where we have the current staffing levels. The new jail is not, there's no face-to-face visitation there. It's utilizing video only, and it didn't address any concerns there. It's sticking to the original plan. But somehow, now we need an additional 10 to 11 staff. For me, that I find that questionable. Lastly, when you do these charts, I could have put red all over the parking lot and said it's unsafe to go there. That's not really the science on construction management and design. This is done to show that somehow there's no feasible way for the public to go in and out safely. The current area in the middle of the two parking lots, construction trailers and construction land down areas, there's already vehicles, as you said, vans going in and out of there currently, and that's open to the public as we speak. That's the large the parking lot area. So the public currently has access. There's vans going in and out there now. There's no concerns articulated currently about dangers to the public. But the way I see it, there's a really feasible way to create a safe pathway with proper fencing, as is done in many construction projects, even those that are bigger than this one, that provide safe routes to the public to utilize. Somehow we're gonna have to provide that same pathway to staff, to lawyers, to people who do the programming in the jail. So there is gonna be some required pathway for staff and for all those folks I just mentioned, that certainly on Sundays where there is no construction taking place whatsoever, there doesn't seem to be a logical argument that we cannot use that same pathway for the public to visit their loved ones on Sundays. Thank you.
Supervisor Parker?
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate all the comments, and I appreciate the Sheriff's Department really working hard to do their best to bring something forward. But I do think that it would be helpful to us to have an independent look at this. So I would like to move that we direct the CAO to oversee the hiring of an appropriate third-party consultant to review these plans and advise the board on our concerns. And I'm talking about operational and staffing. There may be, I don't know if there are any structural changes that are feasible at this point. I would make those minimal, if any, on the addition, but also another look at visitor and public access during construction, to make that possible. I would like to ask that we be provided with a copy of the policies and protocols that are referenced in the current staffing and operations plan, with advice from County Council regarding our ability to influence those. I'm not prepared to support the current plan without some of these steps. So a third-party assessment, a review of the policies and protocols, really a much more effective and robust oversight and management of the rehabilitative and training programs. We didn't even get into that today, but that was a concern I raised last time. And then also the satisfactory resolution of these visitation issues post-construction and during construction. Also, and others have mentioned it, but moving forward with video visitation as one of our options, I think we need to ensure that it remains low cost or free, as promised. Actually, it was promised to be free at the last meeting. The people involved in our jail are often some of the most disadvantaged in our community, and I'm not comfortable charging them to be able to talk with their loved one. So I would like to make that motion that the CAO oversee a third party.
Second.
We have a motion on the floor first to do a lot of things. And a second. I think there's still room for and time for discussion. County Council?
Yes, can I just a little clarification on the direction of the County Council on reviewing some policies? And you're talking about operational policies at the Sheriff's Office in relation to the jail, is that specific?
Yes, in the current staffing and operational report, there are different headings where it says this, this will happen according to the protocols and procedures of the Sheriff's Department. There must be something in place. And it's just that we don't have those in front of us. When I asked the question earlier about who amends and updates those policies and protocols, the sheriff answered, but County Council didn't. That's fine. I'd like to see the policies and protocols and procedures, and I'd also, at that point, like to hear from County Council about the proper way, and the Sheriff may be completely correct, but I was asking for County Council's opinion, so when those come to us, maybe we can get your view as to the board's role in amending those.
I thought it was pretty wise not to answer, but
your time will come. We just don't have to think about it right now.
Yeah, Madam Chair, just maybe a question for our CAO. What's your time frame, Luke, so that Dan can adhere to the potential impact to the grant requirement?
Certainly. So if I understood the supervisor's proposed motion, one of them would be to conduct basically what would constitute a peer review on the existing staffing plan that was conducted not by the sheriff, effectively by the RMA. I think that would potentially, if bids come in early May, I think a decision will be need to be made at that juncture. So we certainly could return at that time and give you an update on where we are with the peer review plan. And in regard to the construction feasibility, that may be something that we want to sit down with the contractor and explore the possibilities and feasibility. Certainly the sheriff has articulated it and his staff a whole host of challenges, but nevertheless, you know, we certainly could work with an engineering construction management firm in partnership with the contractor to see if something could be accommodated. So to answer your question, it potentially the peer review could be a little bit more lengthy, and I would suggest that we come back and visit that as we approach the bid date.
And through the chair, Dr. Bellman, when you have a sense for that, I think part of the sensitivity is the timing for being able to award the contract, and we don't want to jeopardize the funding, and I think those are two separate issues, but I think it would be important for us to know that.
So when would we be able to hear back on whether or not our decision not to move forward with these current plans will be affected by the funding?
So to clarify, what I recommend is that we would be prepared to report back the timing on the peer review, and concurrently we'll be receiving bids, and we hope that there's bids that we're able to, in fact, finance. So all that information will come to us, and we would get back to the board, say, in several weeks and give you an update on the proposed funding for the peer review.
So we actually would sort of be moving forward on sort of two tracks? I want to make sure I'm understanding this clearly. So we've got the protocol, we've got the training issues, we've got the visitation issues. That is going to be a peer-reviewed issue, or is that what we will hire an independent person to look at? And then we've got the plans for the jail over on the other side. I want to be sure that I'm absolutely clear in what it is that we're deciding.
Certainly, if I understood Supervisor Parker's motion was twofold, to conduct a peer review on the staffing plans. And the second was to explore the feasibility of providing access to the in-person visitation during construction, two separate activities. So currently the project is out to bid, and if I understand correctly from staff, that the staffing plan would have to be approved by your board prior to award of bid. So we would come back prior to that time, give an update on the peer review, and a decision could be made about proceeding forward. We'll have the bid numbers in hand, we'll have additional staffing information in hand, we may have some preliminary findings on access during construction, and your board can make a more thorough decision at that time.
Looks like we have a motion and a second. Are we ready to vote? Supervisor Phillips?
Prepared to vote, but I do not support the motion. I think it's an ill-advised use of public funds, and I think it's a threat to, we're getting close to derail the project, and we're going to have a federal judge run on our jails when we do that. I don't think it's a wise course, and I do not support it.
So let's take the vote then. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And opposed?
No.
The vote carries. Thank you very much. Thank you all for your patience. Sheriff, I want to thank you very much for your being here today and bringing forward your plans. And we all have our jobs to do. And I want to make sure that our communication stays open. Thank you.
Thank you.
And with that, we're going to adjourn, take a recess at this point. Excuse me, we're not adjourning, we're recessing. And I'd like to suggest that we reconvene at 2 o'clock rather than 1:30. Is that agreed upon? So we'll reconvene at 2 o'clock. Thank you.